I predict that it is impossible for Israel ever to prevail so long as they do not give the Palestinian people their dignity, the human dignity it is their inalienable right to have. Never mind the starving, never mind the deaths. It's a simple matter of everyone on this planet has a right to their own human dignity. And your enemy's crimes, whether they're shooting rockets at your civilians, whether they are bombing you with suicide bombers, are never an excuse for your state criminal behavior. And it's clear that it is criminal behavior. Now, I still think that we here in Canada have a responsibility to the spirit that prevailed when the Universal Declaration of Human Rights was drawn up by three people. One of them was a Canadian and he did most of the work. So what has happened in the interim? How can we stand here and allow this to happen? We are our brother's keepers, I thought was the idea. How can we allow this to happen? I personally take responsibility every time a suicide bomber commits a murderous act and kills Israelis, because I have not done anything for that poor Palestinian person who was so downtrodden by this unjust system that he saw no other option but to do these types of things. If we give them no way out, what do we expect? It is no different to the world ignoring the Jews while Hitler was massacring them. We were contrite about that. Now we are doing the same thing. We are allowing the Palestinians to face this on their own. I think we need to look inside our hearts and convince ourselves and our friends and our families and particularly our government that we have a moral and a legal responsibility in terms of international humanitarian law to not allow this kind of persecution of people that is going on in Gaza right now.
Specifically, we're here in protest of the siege of Gaza, which in the last 2 months has reached unprecedented levels in terms of restrictions of all shipments of food, of medical supplies, and of power into the Gaza Strip and its 1.5 million residents. The results of this being now the average household in Gaza has less than 8 hours of power per day. We have less than 8% of all households in Gaza which have access to clean drinking water. We have stores that have shut down, bakeries that have shut down as a result of these shortages. A comprehensive manufactured humanitarian crisis against the entire population as part of Israel's ongoing policy of collective punishment, which did not start in the last 2 weeks or in the last few months or even in the last 2 years, but has been an ongoing Israeli policy against the Palestinian people.
As we have heard from many of the speakers today, the siege on Gaza and the ongoing occupation of Palestine is a death sentence for the Palestinian people. Other speakers have talked about the cuts in fuel and electricity and the restriction of movement for people. And I want to talk a little bit just specifically about the health situation and the situation of healthcare within Palestine. From what I understand, the healthcare system has been decimated by this recent siege because of fuel and electricity shortages. Only 11 of 56 primary health care clinics are currently operational due to a lack of fuel and electricity. 107 types of basic medicines have been completely depleted, with another 97 types nearing depletion. 90 patients have died while being delayed or denied access to medical treatment at Israeli checkpoints. And an additional 320 patients are in serious condition and in need of urgent treatment. Ambulances are out of fuel, hospitals are without electricity, and patients in need of urgent treatment are blocked at the border, leaving them to die. All of these results and the sharp worsening of the health crisis in Gaza was knowingly created by the racist and military state of Israel with the near complete political support from US, Canada, and European countries.
I just came back from a month of intense work in Palestine. If people don't know the International Solidarity Movement, it's a nonviolent direct action movement, and basically what we try and do is be a wrench in the wheel of the Israeli occupation. And while I was there, the siege in Gaza was in full flight. It was devastating. And I get home, and what image greets me on the TV? Not Gaza, but these photographers pushing their bloody cameras into the ambulance with Britney Spears to get pictures. And I thought, what a contrast that image from the absolute lack of international media all through the West Bank. It was just devastating to see this happen. For the month, myself and a few other activists, we were in the village of Azun, which is near Kalkilia, and it's a beautiful village. Unfortunately, it's beautiful, fertile, and really close to the illegal settlements. So it was a terrible experience. While we were there, several boys were shot, almost daily incursions by the Israeli military. The ISM role there generally was to stop the military from occupying homes, stand in front of homes where there's sniper targets, and try and get the press out, try and get images out to the rest of the world to show what's happening. Sometimes it was very useful, and sometimes it felt absolutely useless when you arrived a little late after someone was shot. It was a very intense month. Now, despite the terror felt in the West Bank at the hands of the Israeli army and the settlers, the Palestinians in the West Bank still were so aware of what was happening in Gaza. And it was absolutely beautiful, the solidarity throughout the villages, the refugee camps, and the cities, people supporting the people of Gaza. It was absolutely beautiful in Nablus one day, a huge city, where they just had a terrible military occupation, invasion, incursion for several days with curfew, many people killed, many people kidnapped, even medical relief people were kidnapped and homes destroyed. Yet a couple days later, hundreds and hundreds of internationals, Palestinians, Israelis are out there supporting the Gaza people. So it was absolutely beautiful. People are there with images of prisoners, images of people of Gaza demanding that they're free. So despite what's happening in the West Bank, people know in Gaza it's much worse. And I have to say, before I left, I asked the people, is there any message you want me to bring back to Canada? And they said, number one, don't forget us. Number two, tell people, even if we're slaughtered one by one, we're not leaving. And number three, end the occupation.
The occupation is a shame. No more killing in our name.
Occupation is a shame. No more killing in our name.